We are the members of Seifu High School's Biology Club. Today, we would like to give a speech of our research in water bloom's poison. For about 20 years, we have protected a kind of fish called Japanese rose bittering, which is on the verge of extinction. Japanese rose bittering now lives only in these wet coral prefectures, and it's hardly seen in natural pond. Among these districts, we focused on Takayasu District near Osaka, what countryside it is.
However, around our protected pond, we faced a problem of the appearance of water bloom. Water bloom is a gathering cyanobacteria on the surface of the water. If it increases, the quality of the water and the view of the pond get worse and some creatures die. In addition, water bloom produces a strong poisonous substance that is so harmful that it can kill animals and even human beings. So we started to research in water bloom. First, we thought that if we somehow make water bloom cohere and float, we'll be able to catch it easily. To gather it, we used alum as a chemical. When you add the chemical, however, it becomes acid. So we used calcium carbonate as a neutralizer. Instead of melted one, we used chalk powder, which we usually use. We conducted an experiment like that, and we exposed it to 10,000 lux of light. About 30 minutes later, as you can see, all of them cohered and floated. Please look at these pictures magnified by a microscope. The particles of chalk powder is far smaller than those of calcium carbonate and scallop shell. That's why we chose chalk powder in this experiment. Then we conducted an experiment in a pond. We divided the pond and put chalk powder and alum in it. 20 minutes later, both of them cohered and floated, so we could easily catch it with nets. However, we found a problem. Since alum contains aluminium, it has a bad influence on the roots of plants. So we looked for a substitute. Among many kinds of matters, we took notice of iron compounds. That is because iron can help phytoplankton live well. Finally, we chose ferric sulfate. The conclusive reason is that its valence is as high as aluminium, so water bloom can be cohered with a small quantity. Next, we estimated the neutralization point and the ratio of mixture. Look at this graph. When the mole ratio of iron sulfate to calcium carbonate is 1 to 8, the pH becomes almost 7. So we decided on 1 to 2 as the mass ratio of them. Ladies and gentlemen, please watch this movie. This is the experiment in a beaker. And please read the Japanese caption now. The very important point is very quickly. It's very quickly, it's very important. Look at that. Water bloom floats, as you can see. How wonderful it is! Clap your hands! In this way, we established how to make water bloom cohere and float. Then we focused on how to make use of water bloom. We realized that water bloom contains a lot of nutritious salts, such as porcine or our phosphorus. So, we suppose that it can be reused as a fertilizer, but there's a fundamental problem. As I said, water bloom produces strong poisonous matter. It is mainly microcystine. So we look for the way to detoxify it. We tried five means, and measure the density of microcystine by a special key, ELISA. In ELISA, we paint microcystine by antibodies and measure the light absorbency. The higher the light absorbency is, the less poisonous it is. The result is shown by this graph. In any case, we decomposed microcystine, but many problems have yet to resolve. For example, it costed a lot, it took too much time, it lost nutrition, and it had bad influence on the environment. After all, these five means were inefficient. How can we decompose it more efficiently? We wondered. But we discovered, in natural environment, water bloom decreased. Microcystine decreased gradually. So we suppose that there are bacteria which decompose microcystine. So we decided to cultivate bacteria. We tried in three conditions: aerobic, anaerobic, and microaerobic conditions. Aerobic means plenty of air. Microaerobic means no air. And the microaerobic means the middle of them. In aerobic condition, we shake the medium constantly so that fresh air can circulate well. In anaerobic condition, we use a special vacuum pack called anaeropack. Then we put them into the minimum media with bloom water and measure the microcystine with ELISA. First, let us show you the result in microaerobic condition. Please look at this graph. This graph shows how much the colonies of bacteria decompose microcystine. As you can see, number 9 seems to have the greatest ability of them. Then we separated two kinds of bacteria from it and called number 961 and 962. Then this graph shows the comparison of the ability of them. As you can see, 962 was better. After that, we measured how much the number 962 really decomposed microcystine. The result is this. Number 962 completely decomposed microcystine, indeed. How about in aerobic condition? Look at this graph. As you can see, number 1 and 14 seem to have the best ability of them. Then we separated two kinds of bacteria from number 14 and called 14-1 and 14-2. And we compared the ability as well. As you can see, 14-1 was better. How about in anaerobic condition? Unfortunately, however, we couldn't find any powerful bacteria. Next, we tried to specify the bacteria. We amplify them by PCR and analyze their DNA. Finally, 962 was identified as a species of bacteria called Sphingomonas aquaterris. What a strange name. And 14-1 was also identified. This strain belongs to Pictobacillus. What a strange name. Then, we estimated the decomposing mechanism. Please look at this. Microcystine consists of 7 ring structure. We found that its peptidic combinations are cut by bacteria's hydrolysis enzymes. And this graph shows that the amount of microcystine decomposed for 1 month is more than for 1 week. So estimated that in peptidic combination, snap step by step and change into amino acids. And the bottom graph shows that while the bacteria decompose microcystin for 1 month, the nutrition increase little by little. So we confirm it's useful as fertilizer. In this way, we confirm aerobic and microaerobic bacteria as the practical bacteria. By the way, the place where the water bloom increase a lot is the surface of the water, where there are plenty of air. So I guess it may be hard to discover powerful anaerobic bacteria. In this way, we established how to make water bloom coherent, float, catchy, and toxify. So, what we have to do from now is to establish the way to make water bloom into fertilizer. The main problem is that water bloom contains a lot of nutrition, but it's not as much as that of liquid fertilizer, which is on market. But if we improve this method, we will be able to get nutrition inexpensively and make practical fertilizer. As a result, we can solve the global problem of water bloom. Lastly, we are very thankful to them and all who have supported us. Thank you very much for your listening.
ありがとうございました。それではこれよりご質問をお受けしたいと思います。ご質問のある方、挙手を。はい、ではマイクをお持ちいたします。お願いいたします。
I have a question about the degradation product MC, of MC. Do you have any evidence that the degradation product is non-toxic?
Sorry, in Japanese, please.
分解生成物の予測の図を出しておられましたけれども、それが無毒だと。いう証拠はあるんでしょうか。
分解生成物が無毒であるという証拠ですか。
はい。
それはですね、先ほど示しました、このエライザ法での、無毒化実験のグラフがあるんですが。
イライザは毒性を測る方法ではないですよね。構造を核検出するという方法であって、毒性を測る方法ではないと思うんですけれども、やっぱり
赤は毒性を測るためのキットで使用しました。
ちょっと確認してもらったらいいと思うんですけれども、はい、イライザはイライザ、その MC があるかどうかを見てるんであって、その分解物構造が変わったら効かないというか、毒性の試験には向かないように私は思います。はい。
まだ少しそこまでちょっと考えられてなかったんですが、このエライザ法を用いた実験においては、このように、毒性が分解されたというふうに判断しました。
よろしいでしょうか。隣の先生はよろしかったでしょうか。はい、大丈夫でしょうか。では、お時間になりましたので以上とさせていただきます。清風高等学校の皆さんでした。ありがとうございました。